We can start. I welcome to everybody. Thank you very much to the panelists and to the all the people who is following our this webinar. The webinar is about the book that CESPI published, La Turchia nel Mediterraneo, edited by Donzelli and by Valeria Giannotta. It's a project funded by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs International Cooperation, through the Analysis and Planning Unit. We are very glad for the opportunity that they give to us to develop this research project. And I want to give the floor to Mr. Lorenzo Vai, representative of the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, to introduce this this webinar. Please, Lorenzo, thank you.
Thank you, and first of all, thank you to the director, Daniele Frigeri, for this invitation. I also bring the greetings of Giuliana Del Papa, the head of the Policy Planning Unit of the Ministry, who wasn't able to join us today. About the today's topic, just mention that the last year the ministry funded three different research projects on Turkey, and one of these is the project that we presented today in this webinar. The first question is, of course, why so much interest about Turkey? And I think that the best answer is, of course, in the book, in the results of your research. But at the same time, I see at least three different perspectives that underline the importance of Turkey and its action and its relation at the regional level. The first one, of course, it's first of all at the bilateral level. I see in this sense an important relation between our country, Italy and Turkey, as a sort of in a logic of complementarity in different ways, but also the importance and the role of Turkey is very, very important also at the regional level from two different perspectives, I would say, from the European one as European Union and also from a Mediterranean perspective. So in this sense, on both levels, I see a complex logic of cooperation and tensions. And I think that all the contributions in this book are quite helpful to understand better this very complicated logic that characterized the Turkish foreign policy, especially in the last years. And the last point, the last perspective that I would like to stress here today, just very as a very simple input that I give you and I put on the table, is a more systemic perspective and the role of Turkey in the current international system. Just to mention one fact, the role of Turkey, of the country, in the diplomatic context of the Russian aggression in Ukraine is quite important. And I think that this is just a small example of the game that Turkey is also playing on different table. Just another word before to give the floor again to Mr. Frigeri about the role of think tank like CESPI and all the other institutions that the ministry is trying to support in these years. Also, we have research like this one, very important for us, but at the same time, what we're trying to do is a sort of constant dialogue with researchers, with all the institutions. So this is just a part of our collaboration with CESPI. I just mentioned that CESPI this year won another research project, quite different on different topics, together with other Italian think tanks, to organize seminars where researchers, analysts, and also diplomats were meet together to speak and to have a dialogue on topics like this. So on Turkey and on many other countries that are influencing our regional dynamics and of course have an important impact on our national interests. So I think that I will stop here. This was just supposed to be a very brief welcome address. And thank you, by the way, for your work. chess piece as a wall, but especially to the editor of this book, Valeria Giannotta. Thank you for your work. We really appreciate that. And I think that in the following months, we will have new opportunities like this one, but also in another way to keep up our dialogues. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Lorenzo. I want to underline your word is the role of the think tank is to keep open this constant dialogue with the Italian Minister of Foreign Affairs. The idea is to support the work that you do with our research, our reflection. Just to introduce this book, the book was born in the activities of the Italian Observatory on Turkey. That is a project that we are running since a few years, with the idea to look at the foreign policies of Turkey from different perspectives. Make a sort of interaction between the foreign policies and the internal policies and what is going on in the society and in terms of changing on the society, changing the political issues in Turkey. So we try to cover this all this aspect through briefs, analysis, trying to understand the different the evolution of the Turkey in the present and in the future. In 2023 that will be important election in Turkey. But the idea of this book comes also from the growing importance that the foreign policy of Turkey is becoming in all the Mediterranean area. Turkey is working as a regional player. Libya, Syria, but also all the issues in terms of around Cyprus issues. This lead us to try to better understand the role of Turkey in the Mediterranean area, starting from an historical perspective that for us is a clear necessary key to read the present and look into to the future. What was very interesting also for us that is part of our work is to bring together a group of Italian and Turkish researchers. We are very glad for the collaboration. And we, in this webinar, we try to replicate this collaboration, this dialogue between Italian and Turkey. And so we give the floor during this webinar to each of the authors that wrote in this book. Two of them, unfortunately, are not with us tonight. They are very sorry, but they have some other issues. And Valeria, who edited the book, will guide us through the different panelists and the different issues that we try to cover in this book. So please, Valeria, thank you very much. The floor is yours. We have lost Valeria. No, Valeria, okay.
Sorry, I did not open the microphone. So thank you, Daniele, and thank you, Mr. Vai, for your participation and for your notes. And thank you to the panelists for attending this online event. I wish one day we will get together because we have been working from remote and trying to coordinate our efforts from Rome to Istanbul and from Istanbul to Rome as well. But I will say that it was a very positive collaboration. We have spoken about the efforts of Observatory on Turkey, or Turkiye, as the Turkish president is encouraging us to use this new term. But I would like to spend a couple of words about our partners, because this project was possible thanks to the partnership of the Turkish counterpart, and namely the 22 Kuzmais University in Istanbul, who's and the leader of the Turkish counterpart is Professor Michelangelo Guida, who led the team composed by Merve Kutuk Kurish and Ozan Goksel, who is unfortunately he's not here with us today, but he's really sorry. So I think this is another sign of the huge complementarity and the deep complementarity existing between Italy and Turkey. I mean, not just at political level, but also among institutions and among societies. And one of the main assets of Observatory on Turkey has been always trying to establish and enforcing the dialogue with the civil society and academy as well. But going back to our work, it has been, I mean, I would like to thank once again the Minister of Foreign Affairs and the Italian Cooperation and the Unit of Analysis and Policies of the Minister, because they acknowledge our work and our effort. And basically this book in the online format, let's say, this is just an ebook, it's not published as a hard copy, wants to provide a roadmap in order to understand what are the current dynamics of Turkey and Turkey in the Mediterranean basin, in the enlarged interpretation of Mediterranean, because we are not dealing just on the strictly Mediterranean basin, but we try to analyze also the effects and the dynamics in the Caucasus region, like and namely in the Nagorno-Karabakh region, and what was the role of Turkey in that region. We try to understand and analyze what's going on what's going on nowadays, and also taking into account the historical background in the northern Mediterranean region, namely in Libya, specifically in the Middle East as well. And we focus mainly on the current conflict related to the Cyprus issue, because we really believe that if we do not understand what was the cause of the issue in this divided island, such as Cyprus, we cannot understand what's going on nowadays in the region and the spillover effects that over the Turkey and the bilateral relations with some other coastal countries such as Greece and such as some other European countries. But of course, in order to provide such a punctual analysis, we put much effort in order to understand what is the historical background. I mean, our aim was to try to understand and to shed some light on what were the constant point of the Turkish regional policy in the Mediterranean, and what were the game changers, let's say, in the Turkish approach. Therefore, in the first part of our volume, much attention has been dedicated to the historical reading. So one chapter was dedicated to the Republican era, such as from the foundation of the Republic, with some reference to the Ottoman Empire until the rising to power to the party, to the Justice and Development Party, the Erdogan's party, which is leading the country since 2002. And then a chapter was dedicated to the rule of AK Party. And basically we tried to differentiate different stages in AK Party rule. We witness different approaches in the region, such as the so-called zero problems with neighbors, and which basically failed, and then the so-called precious isolationism of Turkey, and then again a more muscular and assertive approach in regional matters, and more recently a more cooperative approach. And then we focus on the society level, because we really believe that overall, in the case of Turkey, the domestic level and the regional approach and international approach overlaps. So we cannot understand why Ankara is behaving in such a way, is taking such decision internationally and regionally without understanding the domestic context, and also the understanding of society and how society shapes the decision making process in Turkey. Finally, in the first part, we address the main ideologies that have been leading the Turkish rhetorics related to regional affairs, and also we focus on the current ideologies that they are just playing the role of a pivoting ideology in the current environment in Turkey. While in the second session of the book, we tried and we selected certain areas and certain topics. And we based our analysis on the importance of the Cyprus issue. So and the importance of Mediterranean in the Turkish interpretation of regional policies. Then we focus on the MENA region, so Mediterranean, North Africa, with a special emphasis on Libya. Of course, from an historical point of view, but putting much emphasis on what's going on nowadays. And then we pass through the Middle East, and specifically the case of Iraq, the conflict between Israel and Palestine. We wanted to address and try to understand what has been the Turkish stance in this conflict, and the situation in Syria, of course, with spillover effect over the Kurdish issues and so on and so forth. And then a special attention was dedicated to the Nagorno-Karabakh issue and the Turkish projection towards the Caspian region and the Caucasus. And finally, the two last chapters were dedicated more to the issues related to the bilateral level between Italy and Turkey, also in the frame of European Union, because we know that Italy has been always supporting Turkey within the European frame, trying to moderate and channel the Turkish stance on the European table. And we focus more on the migration issue, which is, as for Italy and as for Turkey, is one of the hot topic that needs to be addressed, as both Italy and Turkey are the main spot of the migration flow coming from Mediterranean and from North Africa and Middle East. Finally, Ambassador Marsili, with a punctual and very specific analysis also related to his long and deep experience in Turkey as ambassador, gave us a valuable contribution on the bilateral relations between Ankara and Rome, I mean, from an historical point of view until nowadays. And at the end of our volume, we had the pleasure to host a contribution by Ambassador Stefano Manservisi, who served as ambassador of European delegation in Ankara for a long time, and unfortunately cannot be with us today because he's busy with some other engagement. I would like just, and then I will give the floor to the speakers. I would like just to say that our volume wants to provide a sort of a roadmap to the readers. I mean, trying to give the instrument, the tool to understand the dynamics, what is the origin of the dynamics, and also give the tools to forecast what will come next. Of course, you know, we are dealing with Turkey, which is a very dynamic country because it's located in a very peculiar geographical area. I always say that nobody is jealous of Turkey because, I mean, Turkey is surrounded by very problematic neighboring countries, and it's full of, I mean, the location brings by itself several challenges and several problems. And of course, when we were about to finalize our volume before sending
for printing the crisis between Ukraine and Russia was just started, and then it escalated. And also the problems that nowadays, I mean, today we are witnessing again between Turkey and Greece in the Mediterranean, such as escalation of tensions, did not experience that severity in the time, because I think we sent for publication just around April and the situation was quite calm in the time. And also related to Nagorno-Karabakh, the situation was quite stable, while nowadays we are witnessing a sort of escalation of violence as well. But still we believe that putting aside what is the contemporary data, a contemporary event, our volume is academically valuable because it's providing an objective analysis. As it has tried to frame the Turkish stance in the Mediterranean and also in the relations of the connection with the main actors such as European Union. And of course, as we are dealing with the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, we tried to draw some recommendations and trying to understand what are the margin of cooperation or for enhancing the cooperation between Rome and Ankara, or if there is some margin of frictions in certain areas or related to certain issues. So I think this is just a brief introduction. I would propose to proceed just for a sort of logical order, to proceed by giving the floor to the authors and by proceeding from an historical point of view and then giving putting some light on the main hot topic that the authors and the contributors have been addressing, and then in a sort of waterfall logic, going and touching the main case studies that they are including in the book. So if you agree, I will just give the floor to Gianpietro Sette. Of course, I would like to say that some of the chapters, they were just written by several authors. In this case, I mean, all of them, they contributed very well with, valuable sources as well, proving a deep expertise. So I would like to start by providing a point of view, a reading from the Republican era by leading us to nowadays, to AK Party era into 2022. So therefore, I will start by giving the floor to Gianpietro Sette, who is a CESP researcher. He's collaborating with the Observatory on Turkey since 1 year, and that he has addressed this chapter with Luca Severini as well, who is as well a contributor for Observatory on Turkey. Thank you.
Yeah, good evening to everyone. So yeah, as Valeria has already explained, me and Luca started with a brief summary of the development of the international relations of Turkey since its birth. So like the birth of the Republic in 1923 was chosen by us as the beginning, and we proceeded with a brief analysis of the Kemalist revolution, focused on Turkish nationalism and the opposition to Western imperialism. Then we gave a brief analysis of the Lausanne Treaty and the Montreux Convention because of the importance given to the straits of the Bosphorus and the Dardanelles and the Marmara Sea. Then we saw that before passing to the second part, that is the Second World War, we stated kind of clearly that Atatürk's death in 1938 didn't really change the foreign policy of Turkey. That was continued by İnönü. Then in the Second World War, the most important part was the neutrality of Turkey that ended after the conference in order to join the UN. Then we went on with an analysis of Cold War, and where we see an increase in diplomatic and economic relations with the West. So after the receiving funds from the Marshall Fund in 1949, Turkey joined Europe and recognized Israel. In 1950, with the Democrat Party of Menderes that continues the Kemalist foreign policy, until in 1952, Turkey joined NATO. Then the most important news was the detente in 1963 of Turkey with the Soviet Union after the end of the Cuba crisis. And it was reproposed again in 1974 after the unilateral Turkish intervention in Cyprus, that with a consequent isolation of Turkey in the international scene, and an end launched by the Soviet Union. So this started what Turkey developed as a Turkish dualism between the West and the Soviets. This dualism that is key to understand the actual geopolitical decisions of Turkey continued later after the coup of 1980s conducted by Kenan Evren, and it was alternatively used by Ecevit and Demirel in that period. Then still in the 80s, we have the beginning and a clear demonstration of the Kurdish threat that becomes an increasing problem. And that was tackled by Turgut Özal in this period in power, especially like the Özal Yıllar between 83 and 93. Then again, another demonstration of this equal or, well, not exactly equal, but like this distance between the two blocks happened with Iran-Iraq war. And then like after the end of the Cold War, after 89, we saw again, like the prosecution of the initial idea of Özal of being a bridge between the East and the West, something that Turkey is still continuing nowadays. Then in the other chapter I wrote together with Mattia Giampaolo and Aurora Ianni, we saw the relations between Turkey and especially in my case, the part of Syria and Iraq, where I try to state and to explain the main problems still ongoing or solved between the two countries, two or three countries. Those are basically the question of Hatay that was basically solved in 2005. The problem of water concerning the river Euphrates and the terrorist group PKK, especially after 1998, but a problem that is still ongoing. And then for Iraq, similarly, like the problem of water, and then like the increasing and huge investments of Turkey in the oil and gas pipelines, and the problem of Kirkuk. And finally, the still ongoing and very intense problems of the Kurdish question that was addressed in the same chapter, analyzing the what started as a civil war in 2011-2012, and that with a substantial change in 2016, and the final Astana process that tried its best to minimize the cost of war and to ensure national interests, although it didn't really ended as it was initially hoped. So here I would finish my.
Thank you, Gian Pietro. So I would say that what is very important to underline, I mean, to put it to the attention of our public is that, I mean, while in the Republican era, Turkey was pretty much isolated and opted for having an isolating stance in international affairs by looking just to the West and to Europe. When the AK Party came to power, those paradigms changed a lot. Therefore, we saw many criticism and many fear coming from the Western bloc, claiming that AK Party in Turkey was turning its back from the West towards the East. It was just trying to follow a sort of neo-Ottoman agenda and trying to expand its influence all over the region. But what is clear, as you say, that some of the issues, such as the Kurdish issues and Israel, Palestine, and also some positions in the Middle East, they did not change that much. I would say that more than political, they refer to the genetic DNA of the Turkish nation rather than political interpretation of the government. And since the society, I would say it's pretty much important in shaping the decision, I would like to hear the view and of Merve. Merve, she's an academician working in Yirmi Jokuz Mayıs University, and she has been she wrote for us a very interesting chapter trying to analyze and addressing the society. I mean, how the society has changed, or how changing has shaped the decision maker related to regional affairs, or vice versa, how the Turkish stances at the regional level have had impact on the society in Turkey as well. Of course, we are referring mainly to the AK Party age, so starting from 2002 until nowadays, when this, I would say, zeal, this will of public diplomacy became very evident and is still evident in front of our eyes. So, Merve, if you agree, I mean, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Valeria. First of all, please allow me to begin my talk with my sincere gratitude for this opportunity. Thank you, JSP, and our editor Valeria, Professor Michelangelo, Guida, for their invitation, and also thank you, Italian Minister of Foreign Affairs, for their support of the project. So my project examines the Kyrgyz cultural politics at home and abroad. It elaborates on the Kyrgyz strategies to create cultural hegemony based on the principles of Islamic conservatism and neo-Ottomanism. And it analyzes how this project faced a backlash from both domestic and regional actors. My research begins with this, you know, basic argument that since its rise to power in 2002, Kyrgyz adopted a series of policies to establish its hegemony in matters of economy, politics, society, and culture. And even though the Kyrgyz succeeded in building and sustaining hegemonic power in the economic and political realms, I contend that Kyrgyz's politics of producing cultural hegemony at home has failed, especially when it comes to its policies on youth and women. On the other hand, I argue that using culture as a tool of diplomacy to develop hegemonic status in the MENA and beyond achieved only short-term success. But due to the time that we, you know, had no chance to speak beforehand with, and check with Valeria, but I decided to skip the first part and moving directly to the RKP's efforts of reshaping culture at home due to the timeline, if this is, you know, okay with you. So in this, you know, second section that I focus on these cultural policies, politics at, you know, abroad, I discuss how, you know, RKP made use of cultural politics in its foreign policy. This was, in fact, the continuation of the 1980s or Turgut Özal's cultural politics abroad, but the break in Turkey-EU relations changed the RKP's discourse on neo-Ottomanism, for example, moving from the discourse of the early multicultural coexistence discourse to positioning Turkey as a hegemonic power among its neighbors. And another crucial difference with the Özal era also that the RKP aimed to strengthen Turkey's role, not only in the Balkans and Central Asia, but also in MENA. So to this end, I had three focus. I first of all look at how RKP utilized state-funded cultural and educational institutions, such as TİKA, the Turkish Cooperation and Coordination Agency, and Yunus Emre centers. By reconstructing and restoring historic mosques and shrines, or by providing courses in the Turkish language or traditional arts and music, these institutions extended their activities beyond Balkans to MENA. And I also analyzed how RKP collaborated Turkey-based transnational Muslim NGOs in order to enhance self-ascribed hegemonic status by means of soft power in MENA. For example, the Humanitarian Relief Foundation and also government-linked Turkish Maarif Foundation, they contribute to the RKP's soft power and diplomacy efforts. Lastly, I discussed the RKP's discovery of the use of period dramas as part of its foreign policy. For example, Resurrection Art Rule, it's a biographical drama about the father of the Ottoman Empire's founder, or the last emperor portraying the life of the Ottoman Sultan Abdulhamid II. But despite the RKP's massive efforts to culturally dominate MENA by means of cultural and educational institutions, Muslim humanitarian organizations, and popular media products, I argue that it has failed to make a long-term impact. And this is mainly because the balance of power shifted following the short-term Arab uprisings. And Turkey's strong presence in the region provoked anger from regional powers, especially Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Israel. Like, for example, Turkey showing solidarity with Muslim Brotherhood against Sisi and Egypt, or to Turkey's recent military involvement in Libya. So other regional powers did not approve of Turkey's involvement and quickly regarded RKP's neo-Ottomanist foreign policy as cultural imperialism or imperial expansionism. In other words, changing regional power dynamics deeply affected Turkey's soft power capacity in MENA. And here I stress that, and here I refer to both Professor Güd and Göksel. They argue that soft power and hard power are deeply connected, And indeed, a country's capacity for soft power is the byproduct of its capacity for hard power. So in circumstances where soft power is not backed by effective capacities for hard power, like economy, political stability at home, any attempt to maintain cultural hegemony is destined to be a futile endeavor. And this has been the case with Turkey. But I also concluded my research saying that we should never forget that, you know, regional developments are never static. And Turkey recently, at the time I was writing, I was concluding the research, Turkey, you know, just began to recognize the unsustainability of its foreign policy. And there was this talk on normalization with Egypt, Israel, UAE, Saudi Arabia, and lastly, you know, Turkey's role in the talks between Ukraine and Russia. So therefore, it would be safe to say that these meetings are significant in showing that Turkey revitalized its capacity to solve its foreign policy problems, which in the long run will contribute to its soft power capacity too. Yeah, I think leave it here. Thank you.
Thank you, Merve. I mean, I think whoever is going to read our volume and your chapter will be amazed. And, you know, we unfortunately had to make some cut because of the number of characters, but it was a very, I mean, added value to our volume. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
As you already mentioned, I mean, to Michelangelo Guida, to our professor, Michelangelo, I mean, maybe not all of you know, but he's an Italian, as the name say, but has been borrowed by Turkey since a long time. And in Turkey is one of the main leading scholars related to political science and regional dynamics and also Turkish politics. And you mentioned that you engaged in discussion and you read a lot about this combination of soft power and hard power in his work. Also with Ozan. And by going to Michelangelo, Ojam, I would like to ask you, what is the weight of ideologies in shaping the Turkey regional approach? I mean, what has been in the past and what is nowadays, if still ideologies are playing a role in Turkey regional politics? Thank you.
Thank you, Valeria. But just before answering your question, I would like to, on behalf of our small Istanbul equipe, I want to thank the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation for their support. At the same time, also Chespi and his director Frigeri for also. Chespi's support for this project, and obviously you, Valeria, for the kind words, but also for setting up the team and editing the volume with kindness and also firmness. Talking about ideologies, yes, well, basically my chapter was focused on different ideologies and mainly three different ideologies that shape, I don't know, probably not foreign policy, but definitely shape the discourse that legitimizes Turkish foreign policy. And also the aim was to help the readers to little bit wait a little bit the discourse that now Turkish media, Turkish cultures are communicating outside of Turkey. So I focus on these three ideologies and also their myths, their conception of their own identity and the country. And I started, obviously, as also Giampiero focused, well, from the one-party regime, so the founding era of modern Turkey, when the Kemalist foreign policy took shape in this interwar period, and its pillars were basically the establishment and maintenance of the country independence and security of its borders. Now, this policy
was basically the dominating foreign policy, despite the changes in power, has been the dominating ideology for a very long time. Obviously, with updates after the Second World War, when we have the bipolar world that made the communist neutrality policy impossible to maintain. But once again, the decision to side with NATO and the West was mainly to ensure independence and its own security. But once again, Turkish foreign policy had to be reshaped starting with the last period of Turgut Özal because of the fall of the communist bloc. Turkey has looked in this from this period and still is looking for further areas of autonomy and has attempted to extend its influence in the former republics of Central Asia, former Soviet republics of Central Asia, and also in the Middle East, together with all the problems that Merve was mentioning. And one of the problems Merve didn't mention about the Middle East is the problem of the destabilization of the Middle East after the Gulf Wars and the increase also of guerrilla work and the attacks of the PKK on its borders that forced the military to return to a security policy and also a foreign policy based on security, as also the communist ideology was thinking of. Only during the AK Party era, and now is a long era of 21 years, the country has attempted to reformulate the paradigm of its foreign policy with a clear aim of extending its autonomy. And the early model of AK Party was the one shaped by Ahmet Davutoğlu, as everyone of us would recognize, that Davutoğlu was, however, rereading not only foreign policy, but was mainly rereading the country identity, the founding myths, and you remember earlier, maybe he pointed to some form of reshifting of Turkish foreign policy. And also, as has been mentioned earlier, also an identity based on a hypothetical neo-Ottomanism, even if Davutoğlu doesn't use this term. And then there is the second phase of our party, but also the third ideology that I focus on, is that when Mr. Davutoğlu left office, the country continued in its search for autonomy. However, in this search of autonomy, there was no anymore a charismatic hoja like Davutoğlu, and there were also very competing ideologies that tried to influence the political elites in Ankara and also their foreign policy making. Among these ideologies, the most interesting also would appear to be the most influential that has been used very much to legitimize Turkish discourse vis-a-vis Greece or the Republic of Cyprus. And the Eurasian has been, theoretically, is also an ideology that is hostile to AK Party and its founding values. Eurasianism has been very much a tool for legitimation of the country as a maritime power to control key energy sources and to support positive, but obviously definitely very tense relations with Moscow. Now, the chapter that so examined very rapidly these three ideologies and myths, trying to focus also on its differences. However, the chapter concludes that the Kemalist approach to foreign policy based on security is still the dominating ideology, despite the politicians and media discourse. So don't be fooled by the discourse. This is the main idea of the chapter. The other two, Daltolus and Erasinus, for example, have been extensively used to legitimize pragmatic changes, sometimes U-turns in Turkish foreign policy, but are not reshaping the pillars of Turkish foreign policy that remain based on Kemalism. The details, I leave you, the readers, the details that are all in the chapter. And I'll stop you and I thank all of you again.
Thank you, Michelangelo. So what you said, I mean, you explained to us that there are some concepts that they are mainly related to the Kemalist tradition, and as I used to say, to the genetic DNA of the Turkish nation as well. And at a certain point towards your conclusion, you mentioned about the Mavi Vatan, the blue homeland, which is another ideology which is very popular nowadays. It has been popular recently and still popular nowadays. Overall, when we speak about the Turkish projection in the Mediterranean and the limitation of the economic maritime exclusive zone and the critical issues of energy and exploration of hydrocarbons and issues related to Cyprus and Greece as well. Therefore, I mean, you gave me a great asset to bring the ball to Aurora Yanni, who has been dealing with a Turkey stance in the Mediterranean, mainly related to Cyprus and also energy matters and also the relations with Israel, because in this game of the of energy, which is very contemporary nowadays, because all of us in the region, in Europe, we are facing the energy crisis due to the conflict between Ukraine and Russia. So Aurora has been dealing with this, I will say, hot potatoes, not very easy topic to address, but she put a lot of effort, and I think she provided a very objective chapter, and she gave us the tool to understand a bit more, because still this is a pending issue, right? And it's complicating the dynamics as well. So Aurora, thank you so much. The floor is yours.
Thank you for this introduction. Okay, so just 3 seconds to thank all of our partners and also the Ministry of Foreign Affairs for this opportunity. And now let's go to the Eastern Mediterranean. So let's say that Turkey's policy towards the Eastern Mediterranean has been always marked by a hardline approach. So since decades, the Mediterranean Sea have been shaken by territorial, maritime, security and energy disputes. And tensions in the area lie especially in the complicated relations between Greece and Turkey, which have been disputing over a variety of issues, including maritime borders, gas resource exploration rights, the delimitation of airspace, the status of the of some Aegean islands, and migration issues, but also the division of Cyprus. So all of these issues, apart obviously from damaging relations at the bilateral level, have become an integral part of Turkey's relations with the European Union. First, once Greece joined the Union, and then when Cyprus joined the Union after the failed reunification brokered by the UN in 2004. So the Cyprus problem has indeed affected especially the accession negotiation of Turkey to the European Union since the very beginning of the past. And the relation have worsened over the years due to the fact that the Cyprus issue have somehow broadened into an energy dispute. So we all know that Cyprus is still divided into parts, and the northern part is not recognized at the international level, except for Turkey. And apart from the fact that Ankara wants somehow to ensure that the Turkish Republic of Northern Cyprus enjoys equal rights to for example, gas field and resources around the island, all of these parties, such as Turkey, Greece and Cyprus, have totally different approaches when it comes to the delimitation of the contested maritime borders and also of exploitation rights. Because Greece and Cyprus follow the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, which Turkey is not part of, promoting a totally different delimitation based on the Blue Homeland doctrine. Also, to make things worse and complicated in the area, when in the 2000s it became clear that the Eastern Mediterranean was a gas-rich basin, other countries in the neighborhood started to jump in by delimiting respective zones of influence with that of Nicosia and Athens, such as, for example, Egypt and Israel. And there's no doubt that this cooperation was facilitated by their common stance towards Turkey. Since, for example, the power, the rise to power of Al-Sisi, whose relations with Turkey were until at least recently very much tense, but also due to the deterioration of Turkish-Israeli relations, again, until recently, at least since 2010, namely with the Mavi Marmara episode. Then other regional developments ranging from the war in Libya to the Abraham Accords have opened up new scenarios with Turkey entering into a strict cooperation with Libya and the Gulf monarchies aligning progressively their strategic interest with that of Cyprus, Athens, but also Israel. By now, at least over the past year, Ankara has reopened a diplomatic channel with historical enemies, such as some of the Gulf states, but also Israel. The two non-Arab nations in the Middle East have had a lot of up and downs in their history, but the relation have, we can say that somehow it worsened in the last 20 years with Turkey having a strong stance towards the defense of the Palestinian cause, but also a great support to political Islam in the region. But by now it seems that these that were obstacles in the past are not affecting the relations as they did before. So, by now, it is very much unclear whether the evolution of this kind of positive agenda will shift the geopolitical balances in the Eastern Mediterranean, because if it's true on the one hand that the Abraham Accords have somehow opened the door to the Eastern Mediterranean to the Gulf monarchies, by now, it seems that the relations and this reapproachment between Turkey and Israel is somehow focused on the bilateral dimension. And also, until the pending issues between Turkey, Greece, and Cyprus will not be solved, it is hard to imagine that somehow the Mediterranean waters will find peace. So basically, what can be done next? I mean, for example, I'm thinking, and just to conclude, to the role that could be played by the European Union, which can be kind of mediator by promoting some dialogue with all of these actors, for example, through the organization of a fora which cover all of the Mediterranean actors and not just some of them. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, today there is an important summit going on in Prague, which is the European Political Community Summit, which is basically based on the EU 27 plus some other countries in the region and Turkey and some other countries like Azerbaijan, Greece. I mean, of course, as a EU member who had a stake, who has a stake in the region, are called to get together and I think to make a sort of brainstorming. But still, beside that, we are witnessing an escalation of frictions between Athens and Ankara, unfortunately. I mean, despite the fact that we were quite positive when we published the book, because it was the
let's say the cooperative mood that was leading the bilateral relations, but then the frictions erupted as well, and now there is pretty much concern. And of course, when we speak about energy and the region and the maritime exclusive zone, we need to focus also on Libya, because as a retaliation, I mean, since 2019, Turkey and Libya signed a couple of memorandum of understanding for the delimitation of their water. And just 2 days ago, they concluded an agreement on the use of energy hydrocarbons around the coast. So by going to the North Africa, and we know that the game is a bit complicated, because Turkey has tried recently to normalize also the relations with some other key players such as Egypt, but still behind the stage, it seems that things are getting complicating overall in the light of the new agreements with Tripoli. Mattia, what is your assessment on the Turkish stance in this area? Which is very important for Italy as well, by the way, because there is a sort of overlapping of interest between Rome and Ankara in this area.
Thank you, Valeria, and thank you, Cespi, for this opportunity. Well, in this time of deep crisis of energy, I think Libya is playing with Algeria as well a major role. But before to enter in the main topic, just want to make a bridge with what Valeria said about the correlation of national, international effects and factors which could influence the foreign policy of a given country. I think it's extremely important right now to just understand what is going on in Turkey and at the same time at international level. I think at narrative level is too important right now, and what I try to describe in my chapter is to just to have a comprehensive look at the narrative and the use of some words. And I started my chapter on neo-Ottomanism and the use of the neo-Ottomanism with related with the foreign policy of Turkey, especially in Middle East and North Africa, that was once part of the Ottoman Empire. And more especially in Libya, for example, I just want to remind a sentence I reported in my chapter that said, while the Turkish drones were winning battles in Libya, soap opera and telenovelas and the other cultural products were striking the hearts of millions of Arabs that once was part of the Ottoman Empire. I think this part is very important just to understand the role of Turkey in North Africa. And especially if we just take as an example, Libya. So the move of Turkey in Libya was first of all, the end of a process that was consuming in the aftermath of 2011, after the polarization we witnessed in the region, and after the winning, especially the winning of some forces linked to the political Islam, I think the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, and then we can explain why the tension between the two countries, and also in other countries such as Tunisia, for example. So, I think we cannot understand the role of Turkey in this moment and what was happening in 2019, the role of Turkey in some country without understanding what's laid behind this political mechanism. And what I want to report in my chapter was two main factors. First of all, I stress some political and ideological polarization we witnessed in the region. And as I said, the role of the political Islam in the MENA area. So if we see the who supported Turkey in Libya, we can see that the main narrative, even if wrong in my opinion, was that the Turkey supported Faisal, what was the former premier of Libya, Faisal Sarraj, that was described notably in the by the main political enemies in the area, what was linked to Islamists in that period, and it was explained. So as I said, by ideological factors, but also on the role that Turkey assumed during the years after, especially after 2011. So Turkey in Libya in this phase filled a void. A void left, first of all, USA, and then European Union. So the supporting of Turkey to Faisal Sarraj GNA, what was Faisal Sarraj GNA, was the result of main factors. So it was not only political and ideological, but it was also linked to the void and the danger that, for example, an escalation by Khalifa Haftar could represent for the region in general. And here I want to just to join the second part of my chapter, that was also, I underlined the paradigmatic, pragmatic behavior of Turkey also in the region. So as you said, Valeria, tensions with Egypt were so emerged with strength, especially after 2013, after the downfall of the and the coup d'etat of Abdel Fattah Sisi in Egypt. But also we, as I tried to demonstrate, that despite the relation, the political relations were free, were frozen, economic trade relations continued increasing during that period from 2013 to 2020, even after the peak of the polarization in 2019, after Khalifa Haftar decided to invade, to attack Tripoli, and Khalifa Haftar was supported by Egypt also. But we witnessed at the same time that these relations so remained in some ways stable, if we see at economic indicators and trade indicators. So this was in sharp contrast in some ways between these two factors, so the ideological one and the economic one. So, and as I tried to say, that was just to underline the pragmatic behavior of Turkey in especially in the last years. And so this is explained by various dossiers and important issues. So Aurora was mentioning rightly the East Mediterranean issue in some ways. So that the memorandum of understanding signed by Turkey and the former GNA was at the core of this big and huge dispute, but at the same time demonstrated that Turkey wanted to play a role within the region. So the move of Turkey was justified, and in some ways also, in my opinion, was just in this international context was in some ways logic. So it was a logic reaction. So it demonstrated that Turkey didn't want to be isolated within the region, want to play the role. And this is the main characteristic of the Turkey in North Africa. So I had other things, but I think I finished my time. So.
No, I would just say, if you want to add something more, you can,
Sorry. Just some details. So we wrote this chapter in the period where relations. So relations are among some countries that were characterized by depolarization started to restore in some way. So we saw restore relations between Qatar and Emirates. And we saw also the restoring of some relations also between Egypt and Turkey. And I think these relations, especially between Egypt and Turkey, so represented a turning point. So represented also the final point of a process, the process of 2011. So what represented 2011 for the region as a whole. So the 2011, the revolutions we had in Egypt, in Tunisia, and also in Syria, et cetera. So the restoring of relations between Turkey and Egypt, especially, and as we know, so the Muslim Brotherhood is played a central role. So demonstrated in some way that transition is for now, and I don't know if something will happen tomorrow, but for now, I think is a process that is being closed in some way. That is not, so I'm not meaning that, I don't mean that the will not happen nothing within those countries. So I don't mean that in Egypt right now there are no problems and future mobilization, I don't know if in the same dimensions, but will happen. But at the same time, I think that this reapproach in some way close a circle made by political polarization, ideological polarization, and then also a normalization. This is very important in my opinion, a normalization of relations between the political Islam, the front of political Islam, and at the same time, the conservative bloc. Conservative bloc, I mean, so those countries that prefer historically the stability of the region. The stability of the region, I mean the authoritarian stability of the region.
Thank you. So what you say that Turkey is aiming at playing a role in the region that believe it's a natural region, I mean, for Turkey, for its own action, it's pretty much evident. And it was evident also in the Caucasus, where Turkey recently played a role, and it was a real game changer in the conflict between Armenia and Azerbaijan, a conflict that again escalated recently. And just today, Erdogan is supposed to meet his Armenian counterpart, Pashinyan, in Prague. And this meeting, I will say, has two meanings. The first one, because, you know, Turkey is trying to normalize also the relations with Armenia, and they establish again diplomatic contacts and a sort of roadmap for the normalization, at least the diplomatic level. And the second one, because Turkey, of course, by pending and supporting the Azeri cause, the Azeri reason, in any way, is one of the main stakeholders of the conflict. And I'm very sorry because Ozan is not here, I mean, today with us, otherwise he would give a better explanation of all these dynamics. But now, since we are trying to put all the pieces of a mosaic together, and from region, we need also to, from region to region, I will say, we need also to consider the European Union. European Union as one of the key actors in the relations with Turkey, and I will say one of the main source of inspiration also for the democratic development of the domestic political game in the country. But by putting aside the fact that between Turkey and European Union, the relations have been a bit complicated, and they were affected by a sort of mutual frustration because of the accession process, or because of a sort of, frustration related also to the interpretation of politics by the current AK Party government. One of the main common point and strategic issues that is connecting Turkey to European Union is the migration issue. So it has been in the past, nowadays is still a critical issue, and it has reflects
I mean, effect also in the relations with Italy. In this regard, I will pass the floor to Luca, who has been written and co-authored a chapter related to the migration issues and European Union. Thank you. Luca?
In this chapter, with Valeria Giannotta, we basically try to analyze why and how the migration issue is able to influence both Turkey's national and foreign policy. It was chosen to deal with this topic, firstly, because migration has essential political consequences, not only in Turkey, and also because migration will always be present in the Turkish territory because of its position as a natural bridge between Asia and Europe. So taking as a reference period from the outbreak of the Syrian crisis until now, we analyzed the transformations of Erdogan's open door policy, the evolution of the national legislation on migration, the consequences of temporary protection status, and the measures put in place by the Turkish administration for the social cohesion of migrants. In particular, this link between the migration management and the social cohesion of Turkish citizens and migrants will be of vital importance in view of the next presidential elections of 2023, and therefore for the future of Turkey. To analyze this whole series of phenomena, the evolution of the cooperation process between Turkey and EU was taken into account, like the financing of migration management through the IPA instruments, the Joint Action Plan of 2015, the EU-Turkey Agreement of 2016, up to Ankara's change of course on migration and the most recent developments. The EU-Turkey Agreement of 2016 is certainly a fundamental step in bilateral relations between these two actors, and it is continuing to have crucial repercussions also in Turkish domestic politics. Moreover, Ankara's desire to decrease its effort in the migration management, together with the strong will of the European Union to externalize its borders, makes the migration issue a subject on which the next relation between Turkey and the EU, and therefore also with Italy, will have to develop. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Luca. And, you know, I mean, as the cherry on the top of the cake, we have with us the Ambassador Carlo Marsili, who has been, I mean, one of the leading figures of the bilateral relations between Italy and Turkey. And his tenure in Turkey was pretty much related to the so-called golden age of the relations between Turkey and European Union. And the ambassador has contributed to this volume by giving an insight related to the relations between Rome and Ankara, also in the light of his personal experience and expertise. So we are very happy actually to have you among us and to have hosted your article and your chapter in our volume, that we really believe that it helps to give a deeper analysis on our scope. Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. So if you want, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Many thanks to the CESPI director, Daniele Frigeri, and of course to the director of Observatory Turchia, Valeria Giannotta, and my warm regards to all the panelists. As far as the CESPI book is concerned, I was requested to mention our bilateral relations with an eye on the possible frictions and common interests. Historically, we may start from 1911-1912 war for Libya, because the defeat of the Ottoman Empire meant its loss of Libya and the Dodecanese Islands in favor of Italy. And by the way, these two issues are still very relevant in the European geopolitical framework. The lowest point in our bilateral relations was reached in November 1998 because of the well-known Öcalan case. We started to repair them at the end of the last century, in particularly when, after many years of delay, the European Union gave the green light to the accession negotiations in October 2005. I had the chance of witnessing the process in the period. I was ambassador of Italy to Ankara between the beginning of 2004 and the end of 2010. We enjoyed very warm relations. As Italy was the number one supporter of Turkey in Europe, creating also the Friends of Turkey Ministers of Foreign Affairs group, together with Britain, Spain, and Sweden. For example, the Italian Prime Minister Berlusconi visited Turkey 7 times, and the other Prime Minister of that period, Prodi, twice. All the presidents of parliament and senate, ministers and so on came to Ankara and were reciprocated. But the effect more unique than rare in the diplomatic relations, two presidents of republic paid a state visit to Turkey in 4 years, Ciampi in November 2005 and Napolitano in November 2009. In the previous year, in November 2008, the first intergovernmental summit took place in Izmir, and no other country enjoyed similar relations with Turkey. What about now? For sure, a lot of water passed under the bridges. Gezi Park, the unofficial but undeniable end of European accession negotiations, the unfinished up-to-date of the customs union, the failed liberalization of visa agenda, the war in Syria and the restoration of Assad, the Turkish intervention in Libya in 2019, agreement with Al-Sarraj on Eastern Mediterranean, the Azeri-Armenian conflict on Nagorno-Karabakh, the continuous dispute with Greece on territorial waters and the exclusive economic zones on Aegean Sea and Eastern Mediterranean, the revival of Cyprus issue, the Turkish veto to Sweden and Finland's accession to NATO, the Ankara mediation between Russia and Ukraine, until a certain point successful, the Turkish network in Africa and Middle East, Samarkand summit, the Balkan policy. So there are a lot of new developments which might concern or affect our bilateral relations. We will see what's going on today at the informal European summit in Prague, which has been mentioned by Valeria Giannotta. The good news is, in fact, that President Erdogan, we hold bilateral talks with Armenian Prime Minister. But one point I believe should be clear. We do not have problems with Turkey. As I repeated to Jumhuriyet in a recent interview concerning the new Italian government position on Turkey, there is a permanent prejudice on this country, in the Italian political spectrum, and in general on the press, and sometimes on the people at large, which must face and overcome. Because Ankara might be a competitor in certain fields, but France, Germany, and Britain are competitors as well for us. Turkey might have a peculiar foreign policy, but because of its strategical position. And we must understand that some countries more than others are prisoners of geography. The agreements on hydrocarbon and oil in the Eastern Mediterranean, signed a few days ago by Turkey and Libya, should be considered in this optic. So we have to transform the few possible frictions in Libya or in the Balkans or in the energy explorations into opportunities. And at the end of the day, we will realize that between Rome and Ankara, the common interests are by far prevalent, are by far predominant. We share the same opinion on the reform of the United Nations Security Council. We support the same government in Libya. We took the same position in the Russian-Ukrainian conflict. We share the NATO alliance. We have more than 1,300 Italian enterprises operating in Turkey and more than 20 billion euros of bilateral trade. We have a traditional pro-Turkey position in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. I know that some of our partners are not happy for that, but it is a matter of fact. And I am proudly a member of the club. And we are aware that in the Eastern Mediterranean, there is a place for all of us. And because Turkey has 1,750 kilometers of coasts, she has the right of being an energy explorer and therefore an energy hub. And we need to understand once for all that after so many years of useless negotiations between the two communities following the 2004 referendum for the unification of Cyprus, repelled by the Greek side, either state-to-state negotiations will take place on this, or this problem will never be solved, including the ones of the forgotten people of northern Cyprus. So we have a future of fruitful bilateral cooperation. It would be a tremendous mistake to miss this opportunity. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. Indeed, you pointed out a specific topic because in the past days, I mean, several times the Turkish media and Turkish commentators ask opinion about the future of bilateral relations between Italy and Turkey in the light of the last Italian elections, and they are pretty much worried. But as you said, realism will prevail, and it's not time of ideologies anymore, but pragmatism overall in this time of crisis in the region. I think, I mean, it's already 6 o'clock. I do not see any question coming from the public, but I would like just to remark that this experiment of the project between Observatory and Turkey of Istanbul, it has been a fruitful experience for us, also in terms of partnership, of academic partnership and public diplomacy as well for the Italian interest in Turkey and Turkish interest towards Italy. So I will be very glad to follow up this initiative. And once again, I will be very glad to meet all of us around the table and having a dinner or time for discussing face-to-face rather in Rome 1 or Rome 2, which is Istanbul. So I thank you all of you for your attention. And once again, many thanks for your contribution. I think maybe there is a question. No? I remind that if you want to have the ebook, you can download the PDF format from the website of CESPI Observatory in Turkey, which is freely downloadable. And I would like to thank once again the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Cooperation of Italy and the Unit of Analysis and Politics
for the acknowledgement and the trust given to Observatory on Turkey. And I wish you a great evening to my Turkish friend, Yakşamlar. Bye-bye.
Bye, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye, see you. Bye-bye.